This evening, you're in for a treat, actually a double treat. First off, we're going to have a couple of our very young young men that are going to do a few of their things that they're going to be doing last leader. And then right after that, Will Catholic is going to open up our worship services and prayer. And we'll continue on from there with the young men's worship service this evening. I'm not going to run down the full list because, to be honest, we have a bunch of young men that are going to be leading worship tonight as well as next week. It's a blessing here at Long Cedar to know that we have this many young men of so many different ages that are willing to step up and lead in worship. Now, I will mention that the two first young men here to see it get up tonight are, as I said, very young. They've been doing a wonderful job getting ready for this. I know they're excited about it. They're also, I'm sure, a little nervous, as many of us are. So let's be sure to have smiling faces and be excited to know that they're stepping up to take a leadership role in the Lord's church. And someday, looking forward to being an active part of our worship services as well. Before we get started, though, I have some news that Brother Jim shared with me right before the worship begins tonight about Angie Green. This is someone from the Shiloh community that's having some difficulties right now. She's at UAB. She's undergoing a liver transplant, and it didn't go so well. They're not sure if her body is rejecting the liver or not, but tomorrow in the morning is when they're going to find out some further results on this and whether or not we're to go from there. So they've asked us to start off tonight with a special prayer for her, and I'm going to do that right now. And after I finish up with that prayer, Ricky Watson, or as most of us know him here, man, is going to start us off with Bible reading tonight. Let's go to God in prayer for Angie right now. Dear Lord, we come before you now, thanking you for all the wonderful blessings you give us. Thank you for the opportunity to come together and worship you and be able to spend time with our Christian family. We thank you for all the young men that will be leading tonight. And dear Lord, we thank you for their kind hearts and their willingness to serve in your kingdom. Dear Lord, we know there are many right now that need your help. They're sick or have lost loved ones or whatever the case may be. We know there are many who need your healing hand. Tonight, dear Lord, we bring Angie Green before you and ask you to please be with her. Help her as her body is going through a rough time right now, dear Lord. Help the doctors that are administering to her. We pray that if it be your will, that she can, the liver transplant can go well, and that she can return to her normal walks of life and to her normal health, dear Lord. Just bless all those that are involved and help the best outcome to be possible, dear Lord. And we know that everything that happens works to your will in a certain way, dear Lord. Sometimes we might not see it right away, but we know that you have everything in your hand and you care for us all day. Dear Lord, be with us now as we go through this worship service. Help us to have open minds and open hearts to hear the words of the songs that we'll be singing, to listen to the Bible readings from your word, to listen to the heartfelt words coming from these young men tonight who will be bringing lessons to us from your word as well. Dear Lord, we thank you for everything, but most of all for your Son. It's in his name we pray.
He made me lie down in the rain after he
To see that the future of the Lord's church, even with the young men that we have, and wonderful blessing of so many in the youth group, is in good hands in the coming years. But then you look at even the younger men past that, it's a wonderful blessing.
country to work with and worship Him freely. Lord, at this time, I ask you to be with the sick and those who have lost loved ones. Lord, come to them as only you can. Be with the soldiers there in foreign lands and bring them back home safely and soon. Lord, be with the leaders of our nation at this time and allow them to make good decisions and let us thank them for your name. And allow us today to take some from these lessons that we're about to hear and apply them to our everyday walks of life. And it's in your Son's name.
He knows. In Matthew 25, 35, Jesus said, "For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you took me in." This verse reminds me of my mom, was one of our local, the teacher from our local schools. Every day she would go into the lunchroom. She would ask the students who were already eating, what was her day, and what their lunch meal. Well, on this particular day, she was leading the class in the lunchroom. She saw a group of third graders having lunch. Now, on this particular day, on the menu was spaghetti. I don't know about you, but lunchroom spaghetti, it's not mine. It's not as good as mine. So she went over to the group of third graders, started asking them how their day was and what's their lunch food, like always. Then one little boy looked at my mom. He had spaghetti all over his face. And he said, "This is the best spaghetti I've ever had." Well, my mom continued to start the line. She told one of the lunchroom workers that they had made one young man's day. And the lunchroom worker said, "Point him out to him." So my mom did. The lunchroom worker said, "Oh, that's Daniel." "Daniel," my mom said. The lunchroom worker continued, "Yes, that is the only hot meal that Daniel gets today." This just broke my mom's heart. As she continued to talk to the lunchroom worker, she found out that the workers had been putting together leftovers, what they could, into bags on their take home. In the Bible, we learn of prophets, or messengers from God. Isaiah was one of the most important prophets because he had some of the most important messages to tell people. For example, Isaiah was the one who told people that Jesus would be born of a virgin, which is stated in Isaiah 7:14. "Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and call his name Emmanuel." He also told people that Jesus would be killed by crucifixion, which is stated in Isaiah 53:6-7. "All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned, everyone, to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed, and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He was led as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before its shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth." See, Isaiah had a marvelous vision of God in the heavenly temple. He had this vision when King Uzzah had died. Now remember, Isaiah lived many years before Jesus came to earth. Years after Isaiah had this vision, Jesus came to earth to be born. He grew to be a man who lived a perfect life. And then he was killed on the cross for your sins and mine. Isaiah also humbled himself before God, confessed his sin, and then God cleansed him. He was ready to do the will of God. Isaiah 6:6-8 says, "Then one of the seraphim flew to me, having in his hand a live coal, which he had taken from the tongues from the altar. And he touched my mouth with it and said, 'Behold, this has touched your lips. Your iniquity is taken away, and your sin is purged.' Also I heard the voice of the Lord saying, 'Whom shall I send? Who will go for us?' Then I said, 'Here am I, send me.'" Isaiah heard the Lord ask, "Who will go for us?" God wants us to go and do his will and serve him and tell others about him. Just as we find in Matthew 28, where we are given the Great Commission. What he seeks is one who is willing and ready to go. Now Isaiah was ready. It's like he raised his hand and waved to God, saying, "Here, God, why not me? Send me." Isaiah was a great man of faith. Isaiah didn't know where God would send him. All he knew is that he was ready to go out and do the will of God. Sometimes I think it is so easy going to foreign countries to spread God's word. Because number one, it's a neat place to go and see how our countries live. Number two, maybe it's because we feel comfortable sharing God's word with others who do not know us. We all have that comfort zone. Some of us find ourselves ready and willing to go do the will of God, while others are not. It could be that we're concerned that we're not living exactly how we should be, and others will question it. Well, just as Isaiah, all we must do is ask for forgiveness. And through Jesus' blood, our sins are washed away. Through prayer and study, we can do the will of God. You don't have to travel outside the United States to share God's word. You don't have to leave your state to share God's word. Better yet, you don't have to leave your community to share God's word. There are people to come back doors. We need to see the love of God through us.
There is a saying.
Sometimes we're the only Jesus some people ever see. We're his hands, his feet, and his voice. You may have heard this one. We're the only Bible some will ever read. Even though some people may never pick up a Bible and read it, they read our lives as Christians. Therefore, they watch us closely and we must guard our actions. Are you ready to share God's word to others and let others see Jesus in you? Is there a Daniel, like the little boy that my mom met, in your community that is in need? Are you willing to raise your hand and be like Isaiah and say, "Here, God"? First song will be number 756. 756 versus the last verse.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus. Sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, he'll prepare us a pleasure when we all get to heaven. One day, on a day of rejoicing and glory, when we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout a little shout of victory. Onward to the prize before us, soon his beauty will behold. Soon the pearly gates will open, we shall
number 216, He leads me, the first and last verse.
He
whatever I do, wherever you'd like to be marked in your song books, the invitation song this evening will be number 667. 667. It's good to see all of you here for this evening, worshiping with us. You're visiting, but considering you're our guest, and we hope you'll come back in time to continue to worship with us here. It's past November, when we had our youth group fall retreat that Pastor Grant and I organized, and they did a wonderful job at it. Pastor asked me to do a devotional that Friday night on reaching for the cross. Well, when I thought about what message to bring this evening, the thought crossed my mind that in all stages of life, we need to stop and think, are we reaching for the cross? Well, the question is, how do we reach for the cross? Well, it's a very simple answer. We follow the steps to salvation when we baptize. Many people in the world today, they just go through the motions, and I don't think they stop to look at the importance of the sacrifice. And many of us that did look at the importance, I fear that we fall away from really analyzing the importance and remembering it every time we come to worship God. So I'd like to look back at the basics and go to our roots and look at Jesus' sacrifice. Please turn with me to Matthew chapter 27, verses 27 to 31. Matthew chapter 27, verses 27 through 31. Then the soldiers and the governor took Jesus into the praetorium and gathered the whole garrison around him. And they stripped him of a scarlet robe, and when they had twisted a crown of thorns, they put it on his head, and a reed in his right hand. And they bowed the knee before him and mocked him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews." And they spat on him, took the reed and struck him on the head. And when they had mocked him, they took the robe off him, put his own clothes on him, and led him away to be crucified. But let me set the scene for you here. Just before this, he had stood in front of Pilate to face trial on the crimes that the Jews had said that he committed against them. They wanted him to take the place of Barabbas. There was a prisoner named Barabbas, he was a notorious criminal, as the scripture says. Here in these verses, we see that the whole garrison was gathered around. Many scholars agree that the garrison was a chariot. A chariot of Roman soldiers was made up of 600 soldiers, 600 men. Now let that sink in for me. 600 soldiers mocked and beat our Savior. They even put a crown of thorns on his head and a reed in his hand, make him look like a king after they put a scarlet robe on him. After they had their fun of spitting on him, beating him, and mocking him, they took the reed from his hand, and they hit him in the head that already had the crown of thorns embedded in his head. Jesus went through all this beating, and then he carried the cross. Many people in the world today, when they picture the cross, they think of wood that we would use today that's been sanded, cleaned, almost like 2x4s. But that would not, and they think, that wouldn't be that bad to carry. But the truth about it is, the wood was anything but that. Many historians say the top of the crosses the Romans used for crucifixions weighed anywhere from 350 to 400 pounds, and sometimes even 450. The traditional way the crucifixions took place was that when they got to the top of the hill, after being led through the city, chained, if the prisoner made it to the hill, they would put them on the cross by putting nails in their hands. Now, a lot of pictures that are shown, they tie a rope around the wrist and around the bar to keep them from falling off of the nails. But it wasn't just any nails. It was usually spikes. Most of you, whenever you see a railroad, you see a railroad spike. It was nails like that. Then they were usually left there to hang until they ran out of energy to hold themselves up either with their legs or their hands. So they could not get breath and they would simply suffocate. Many people, they think, well, that's just horrible. But it didn't stop there. Drop down if you would in verse 38 to 44. Verses 38 through 44. The two robbers were crucified with him, one on the right and another on the left. And those who passed by blasphemed him, wagging their heads, and saying, "You who destroyed the temple and built it in 3 days, save yourself. If you are the Son of God, come down from the cross." Likewise, the chief priest also, mocking with scribes and elders, said, "He saved others, himself he cannot save. If he is the King of Israel, let him now come down from the cross, and we will believe him. He trusted in God, let him deliver him now, if he will have him. For he said, 'I am the Son of God.' Even the robbers who were crucified with him reviled him with the same thing." You may be thinking, this is too horrible. In all honesty, it is. But a crucifixion was not meant to be pleasant. It was meant for prisoners, murderers, rapists, anyone that could be considered scum of society that you wouldn't want walking around with you. So there's a light at the end of this dark tunnel. And that light is the love that Jesus showed to us through this death on the cross and his resurrection. Jesus died so that we may have salvation through this death and resurrection. As we all know, he was resurrected on the third day. And we do the five steps of salvation to get the salvation. And those are: hear the word of God, believe that Jesus is the Son of God, repent of our sins, confess Jesus, be baptized, and live faithful. As I was thinking about this lesson I wanted to present, I thought about the song that many times we sing with the youth group. And we sing that devotionals a lot. And the song is called, "Can You Still Feel the Nails?" The message of that song fits well with this. And the song goes like this: "Can He still feel the nails every time I fail? Does He hear the crowds cry 'Crucify' again? Am I causing Him pain when I know I've got to change? Because I just can't bear the thought of hurting Him." And we cry, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord." When I think of the message of this song, I ask myself, and I want to ask you, if we were at the foot of the cross, and I handed you a hammer and a nail, and asked you to nail Jesus to that cross, many of you, if not all of you, would say, "I can't do that." And I couldn't either. But every day when we wake up, Satan is standing there with a hammer and nail. And every time we sin, we hit that nail just one more time. It was our sins that held him on that cross. But this all ends on a positive note. Through all that, we have our sins forgiven when we are buried with Christ in baptism. I've heard Tim say before, and he makes a very good point when he said it, that Jesus' arms were stretched out on the cross. One hand reached to God, and the other reached to man, and he closed the gap that sin had made all those years before. All we have to do is reach for the cross and reach for Jesus and follow him. This evening, there may be some of you here that have not put Jesus on in baptism and reached out for the salvation that Jesus gives. Or some of you may have fallen away and have quit reaching to grow closer to God and trying to reach for things in this world to satisfy you. You can come forward as together we stand and as we sing.
There is power, wonder working power in This evening I'll be singing number 655, verse 5, verse 3.